بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد المبعوث رحمة للعالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد اللهم صل صلاة جلال وسلم سلام كمال على حضرة حبيبك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وغشه اللهم بنورك كما غشيت سحاب التجليات فنظر إلى وجهك الكريم وبحقيقة الحقائق كلم مولاه العظيم الذي أعاذه من كل سوء اللهم فرج كربنا كما وعدت أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكف السوء على آله وصحبه آمين
اللهم صل وسلم
In fact, tasawwuf has always been part and parcel of the Muslim faith. For centuries, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have taught us since the day Jibreel alayhi salam came and visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the presence of the Sahaba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked the three main questions, which all of you know: what is Islam, what is Iman, and what is Ihsan. In his answer to what is Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given a very clear answer. He has told us what are the five main components of Islam. When he was asked about Iman, he also gave the six main articles of faith. But when he was asked about Ihsan, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a very broad answer. He did not tell us exactly what it is. He told us a very broad thing. He said to worship Allah as if you see Him, for if you see Him not, He definitely sees you. أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. So he gave an answer that did not include steps and left it to people. And Muslims have understood from this hadith known as Hadith Jibreel, which is narrated in Sahih Imam Muslim. They have understood from this that the faith or Islam as generally cannot be completed until it is composed of these three particles, these three ingredients. That a Muslim life needs to be fulfilled by fixing his relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that happens through ibadah and through aqidah, through fixing his ibadah, his outward, and fixing his heart, his inward, and then linking both of them by fixing his suluk, fixing the way he conducts himself in a social context. And for centuries there has been three main jobs that are related to the faith. There were muftis or scholars who catered for the ibadah of people, who provided fatwas to save people from falling into mistakes in the way they conduct themselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there has been theologians who defended the faith against those who put forward misconceptions to save people's hearts. And there has also been murshids or spiritual leaders who worked to save people's souls. So we had scholars who worked for people's bodies, their ibadah, and we had theologians who worked to save people's hearts, and we had spiritual leaders or murshids who worked to save people's souls. And this, we can call this the Muslim trilogy. This trilogy of Muslim in the Muslim mind has continued to exist, and Muslims found this as a complete understanding of the faith, fixing their outward and fixing their inward and linking both together. The role of the murshids became, or the spiritual leaders, became even more important as Muslims started to go out from the Arabian Peninsula and travel in the world, and money and luxuries and life started to distract people from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the role of the people who linked them with Allah became more important, as they needed to save them from plunging into worldly allurements, saving them from their own souls, and reminding them of the purpose of their existence. And the link between Alamul Ghaib and Alamul Shuhada, the link between the realm seen and the realm unseen, has always been there. And the link between the Sharia and the Haqiqa, or the outward and the inward, has always been there in what we call Tariqa. So the link between Sharia and Haqiqa is Tariqa, has always been there. And Muslims for centuries have listened to the people of Allah. Scholars have listened to the people of Allah when they had a problem with their own scholarship. Rulers and governors have listened to the people of Allah. It's narrated that Sayyidina al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili radiyallahu anhu, when he came from Tunisia to Egypt and he arrived, some people who disliked him from in Tunisia, some worldly scholars who disliked his way of teaching, they wrote to the king of Egypt that a dangerous man is arriving at your land. As soon as Sayyidina Abu al-Hasan arrived, some Bedouins whose sheep were confiscated by the king approached him and they said, "You are a holy man, can you speak to the king to release our sheep, give our sheep back to us?" So he went and spoke to the king, but the king said to him, "You are coming to intercede for those people, you should be interceding for yourself. I have actually received some news that you are a troublemaker and I'm not going to let you go from here, I'm going to imprison you." So Sayyidi Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili read something that made this king completely paralyzed. And then he moved away. When he moved away, the people who were sitting with the king, they went to the king and started moving him. He was unable to move. So they ran to Sayyidi Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhi and asked him to recite something to relieve him from the state he was in. When he came back and he recited, the king realized the power of this man. He realized that this man is not just a simple person, that he is a sacred man. So he kissed his hand and he said, "This land is not mine, this land is yours, you can do anything here." And Sayyidi Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a lot of openings from that day on. And the people of Tasawwuf were not actually away from public life. They were part and parcel of public life all the time. They were always in conversations and dialogues with the current scholars, with their contemporary scholars. They played a big social role in relieving the problems of people, and they were like an intermediary between governments and rulers and their masses. And they did that only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as part of their fulfillment. It is also narrated that Sayyidina Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili radiallahu anhu wrote one of his ahzab, Hizb al-Nasr, when the crusaders were attacking Egypt. And he said that if people in the army were to recite this Hizb, the crusaders will not be able to take over Egypt. People, the masses respected the people of Tasawwuf because they realized that they are the refuge at times of problems and hardships. Their leadership was not on people's bodies, but it was on their souls. And we can say that the dunya scholars or the religious outward scholars gave and understood and recognized their leadership as well. Sidi Ahmed al-Badawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu lived in Tanta. When the crusaders took over Egypt, he used to use his karamat to bring the captives in chains from the camps of the enemies flying back to Tanta. And the poets of that time used to praise him and say, "How great that al-Badawi brings back the captives." And they say the Muslim Ummah did not only celebrate the people of Tasawwuf when they were physically alive, but they even celebrated them more when they moved from this world, when they left this world. The Muslim Ummah did not only celebrate the people of Tasawwuf when they were physically alive, they also celebrated them after they passed away. So on a linguistic level, they wouldn't say about a person who has passed on from this world, they would not say that he is dead. They will say in Arabic al-muntaqil, the one who just moved. And therefore they made shrines and maqams for them to know or to say that these individuals are still alive in their graves. We can easily say that there is not a single big mosque in the Muslim world that does not have a shrine. Starting from the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, going to the centers of learning like Al Azhar Masjid in Egypt and the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, and even moving to mosques like Al Zaytuna and Al Qarawiyin in Morocco and Al Zaytuna in Tunisia. So that shows us how the Muslim Ummah have looked up at the people of Tasawwuf and how they respected them and loved them. They recognized them as the real inheritors of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they recognized that the main purpose of the message of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is to guide people to Allah, to take the khalq to the haqq subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they went on and established mosques and established ribats and established madrasas and established schools and charities and associations that help and serve the Ummah. And they were in the forefronts of the armies that faced the enemies of Islam. To the fact that a great leader, one of the great leaders of Islam, Salahuddin al-Ayyubi, graduated from one of the madrasas that were established earlier by Sayyidina Abdul Qadir al-Jailani.
ഇസ്ലാമിക ലോകത്ത് അറിയപ്പെടുന്ന ഏറ്റവും വലിയ ധീര യോദ്ധാവ് സലാഹുദ്ദീൻ അയ്യൂബി റളിയല്ലാഹു അൻഹു യഥാർത്ഥത്തിൽ ഷെയ്ഖ് അബ്ദുൽ ഖാദിർ ജിലാനി തങ്ങൾ അവരുടെ മദ്രസയിൽ നിന്നുള്ള ഒരു ഗ്രാജുവേറ്റ് ആയിരുന്നു. അവിടുന്ന് പാസായ ഒരാളായിരുന്നു.
But just like any other ideology and any other long-standing madrasa, tasawwuf has got its ups and downs. It went through phases of weakness, not because of the tasawwuf itself, but because of people's understanding of tasawwuf and sometimes taking it out of context. And unfortunately, over the past 2 centuries, over the past 200 years, some people appeared in the Muslim world who started to misuse some wrong practices of Sufis to attack the Tasawwuf itself. And point one in today's talk is we got to separate the person from the idea. Being a bad person does not mean that your idea is bad. It is natural that people fail to stand up to the principles they have been taught. Because if we say that being bad means your ideas are bad, then we might end up saying that Islam is bad because there are so many bad Muslims. Attacking principles have to be separate from attacking individuals. And evaluating ideas have to be separate from evaluating individuals. But unfortunately, those people started to depreciate the Tasawwuf and attack it because of wrong practices of some Sufis, and also due to their own misinterpretation of what Islam is. They even went to the level of saying that Islam and Tasawwuf are two parallel lines that will never meet. Some funny things like Muslims are either Sunnis, Shi'is or Sufis. Not understanding that Tasawwuf is a madrasa that can accommodate everyone. It is just like saying about a juice that it is either apple juice or water. It's actually water that is infused with apples. Just like saying that apple juice is just apple and water. It's actually water infused with apples. Or another way is just like saying that human beings are either men, women or humans. Doesn't mean anything. Because men and women are basically humans. So this is abuse of intellectual logic. So Tasawwuf started to be faced with a challenge, which is to reprove to people that it is actually part and parcel of Islam. And that was mainly with the masses, because the masses love very easy solutions. And Tasawwuf by its very nature is a very in-depth understanding and interpretation of life. Since people love to shop for cheap things, they wanted the other option. Since people want to shop for the cheap things, this is by nature, they wanted to go for the other options, not Tasawwuf. It takes time to convince someone to shop for genuine things, because they have to pay a lot for it. They might be taken aback by the price that they are paying, and failing to see the value of what they're going to enjoy, especially if that valuable item does not look as attractive as the other cheap item. And the scholars of Tasawwuf had to convince people that it is genuine, even if it might not be as attractive. Many people are put off from taking a long journey only when they see the hardships that they have to go through, not realizing that that journey is important to reach to their destination. And for a certain point in history, over the past 2 or 3 decades, the scholars had to convince people that Tasawwuf is part and parcel of Islam. They had no time to explain to people what Tasawwuf can offer to them. When someone does not have identity, you should be busy proving their identity first before you talk about their virtues. And this is what the scholars have done over the past few decades. So people like Shaykh Ahmed Zaini Dahlan, the Mufti, Shafi'i Mufti in Mecca, has actually wrote books on proving that what these individuals are saying is wrong. People like Sayyid Muhammad bin Alawi al-Maliki, rahimahullah, wrote on how to remove the misconceptions thrown at Tasawwuf. And people like Shaykh Yusuf al-Dijwi, one of the great scholars of Azhar, wrote also in response to that challenge. And the leader of the Shaziliyah Muhammadiyah Tariqah in Egypt, Shaykh Muhammad Zaki al-Din Ibrahim, wrote also in responding to that challenge and at the same time criticizing fake Sufis. They differentiated between a mutasawwif and a mutamaswif, someone who is a real Sufi and someone who is a fake Sufi. And they even said that there is a third category, al-mustaswif, someone who pretends to be. And they said that the main problem of tasawwuf nowadays is that a lot of people who contribute to Tasawwuf are away from Sharia. And that to go back to the original state of Tasawwuf, the original Tasawwuf, we just need to bring Sharia and Haqiqa together. As they always say that Sharia and Haqiqa are like the two sides of the same coin. And also they say that the one who seeks Tasawwuf without being into Sharia will go away from the faith. And then the one who seeks Sharia without leading him into Tasawwuf is also far from perfection.
Far from?
Perfection. Now with this challenge a little bit answered and responded to, we come to the main core of this talk today. As a second challenge started to appear in the horizon, but that challenge is not only facing Tasawwuf, it is actually facing faith in general. We live in a world that is actually smaller than a village. People are turning away from faith so rapidly. A lot of people are throwing away the chains of the faith. A lot of people are throwing away the chains of the faith, thinking that it is actually limiting their movement and their productivity. They think that they should live a free life, that has to be away from the faith. They don't realize that actually faith liberates man. So in the middle of all this, a question would rise, is Tasawwuf still relevant? Shall Tasawwuf remain in history books or dictionaries, or shall we take it out and put it into real life? In some recent research is done by UAE-based Taba Foundation on what are the reasons that are leading a lot of Muslims to leave Islam and become atheists, the questions were, what are the most annoying things that have led you to lose faith? And answers included many reasons, the most important of which are, one is, some scholars adopt very rough and harsh way of presenting the faith. Another answer was, we see a disparity between faith and action. In fact, I believe, and I have seen, that behind everyone who has left faith, there is also always a traumatizing experience. He must have been abused, he or she must have been abused in one way or another by someone who claims to be a scholar. So he or she must have been abused by someone who claims to be a scholar. So we keep convincing them that your problem is not with faith, it is with that individual. Some answers come as, faith has become very dry and focuses only on the outward. So in reality, these are very alarming answers that stress the importance of talking about tasawwuf and its relativity and its relevance to the relevance of spirituality to the Facebook era. So we can ask a simple question. Can we retweet tasawwuf?
Pardon?
Can we retweet tasawwuf? Can we reintroduce tasawwuf? Will we get many likes from people if we present tasawwuf to them today? And I can say that there are about 7 areas that tasawwuf can serve the humanity better in. We live in a world of emptiness. People definitely enjoy more than the previous generation. We've got very big malls, but very small time.
Pardon?
We have got very big malls, shopping malls, but very small time. We've got very huge TV screens, but very narrow minds. We've got very fast ways of communication, but very slow processing mind. We have 24/7 services of almost anything and everything. Innovators and technology experts are trying their best to provide comfort for hungry customers. People are unable to keep the same pace of people who are inventing things. Production is becoming even more than consumption. We can say that there is something new every day, yet man feels a vacuum in his heart. Repeated attempts to fill this vacuum have failed. They might be able to give a temporary relief, but they cannot give a permanent one. These attempts can give a temporary relief to man, but it is not a permanent one. A pain relief rather than taking an acute medication. So it is a fake feeling of satisfaction, because they fail to answer the focal question, what are we doing in this world? Many people are deluded in thinking that we're here to stay. They don't understand that no one is allowed to settle before he reaches his final destination. A traveler cannot just decide to live in the plane. You cannot also decide to live in the airport.
You cannot?
Also decide to live in the airport. your destination is the only place you can live in. We live in a world where we have big houses, but it is not home anymore. You will find that a typical family who have got access to technology, everyone is having his own technology method and is living, staying in the corner and dealing with the outside world rather than the inside world. Sometimes it's easy for a family to communicate on WhatsApp rather than to speak face to face. Sometimes it's easier for a family nowadays to speak on WhatsApp rather than to speak face to face. Century Sufi Ibn Ata'illah Sakandari depicts this exact problem. And he actually summarizes it in a very beautiful way. إِلَهِ مَاذَا وَجَدَ مَنْ فَقَدَكَ أَمْ مَاذَا فَقَدَ مَنْ وَجَدَكَ. He says, my Lord, what will a person find if he loses you, and what will a person lose if he finds you? What will a person find if he loses you, and what will a person lose if he finds you? So the main role of Tasawwuf today is to make people's life meaningful. It's to tell people that their life is meaningless without Allah. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى, that you worship Allah as if you see Him. To live a life that is always connected with Allah. Once that connection stops, this life will become useless. We live in very long days in which Allah does not have any share. Yes, we might be praying 5 times a day. We might be fulfilling the basic duties, but there is not even half an hour every day in which we just focus on remembering Allah. We don't realize that we need this calmness in order to be able to function for the rest of the day. And therefore we become very exhausted and we become very distracted. An exhausted soul and a distracted mind can never serve better. When you are exhausted, you cannot do your work. And this has actually happened because, and this is the second area, because man has been so devalued in this world. Everything around us is telling us that man is the most devalued item in this world. From fast food restaurants that give very limited options to people as if they are not humans, to reducing man's value to some digits. So in government records, he's just a digit. And in the banks, he's just a digit. And even on the internet, he's just a group of passwords. So we don't see the value of a human anymore. We see the value of digits. And the value of digits is limited, while the value of a human is unlimited. Because digits is the creation of man, while man is the creation of Allah. And the creation of Allah is unlimited, just like the Creator Himself. That's why Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when people wished to have many things, he said, I wish I can have a house full of people like Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. The importance of human resources. What tasawwuf can give us is nowadays is to value man. A human being, that he is the master in this universe by liberating him from his own desires that make him a slave of everything else. And therefore it calls anything other than Allah al-aghyar, the others. Therefore it calls anything other than Allah the others, regardless of how different from each other they might be. Regardless of how different from each other they may be. These others, it could be anything, that is different from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It might be different in nature, but at the end of the day, they are one thing, al-aghyar, the others. And as a human being, as a slave of Allah, you should be the slave of Allah alone. You get your status in this world only by becoming the slave of Allah. And you get your value by liberating yourself from others. Tasawwuf also can help in representing Islam. Because tasawwuf is based on mercy and witnessing the essence of every being, human or non-human, and showing mercy to them because they are the creation of Allah. Nothing can win people's hearts more than being merciful to them. Nothing can win people's hearts more than being charitable towards them. Many people nowadays have exhausted souls. Even when they come asking religious questions, in reality, they are not religious questions. They are just spiritual problems. And what they need is just a good word. And the good word will come only when you recognize their weakness. Tap on their shoulders and tell them that you know that they are humans. And the nature of a human being is to commit mistakes. And the nature of human beings is to be exhausted. Tasawwuf will win people's hearts through this. Otherwise, Islam will be very dry, because you have taken the spirit and the soul of it. Ibn Ata'illah al-Sakandari also talks about this. He says, "Al-a'malu suwarun qa'imah." These are just like facades, or just like bodies. They will not be fruitful unless there is sincerity. Like a body will not be able to move and alive unless there is a spirit and a soul inside. Also, tasawwuf can help in the area of navigating in this world. Sayyidi Abu al-Hasan al-Shazili radiallahu anhu wrote a hizb called Hizb al-Bahr. In his hizb radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he taught us how to navigate this world in an easy and relaxing way. And he said in one of the statements there, "Oh Allah, make our affairs easy for us and give us relaxation of the heart." Because many people nowadays live their life without relaxation. Tasawwuf teaches us that this life is not the destination, and that its nature is similar to the nature of an ocean. When you're sailing in an ocean, you're expecting waves at any time. So when waves come and attack you, you are already having trust. When you have faith in your Lord, yes, you build your ship, but expect the trouble. Many people face failures in this life because they don't expect the troubles. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that if this dunya shows some toughness, that is part of its nature. And this is what the tasawwuf teaches us, that it is part and parcel of this life that we face troubles in it. That you plan things, that you should plan for things, but understand that you are part of a bigger plan. And you will be more relaxed when you trust His plan rather than yours. Because Allah's plan is based on knowing the world properly, but your plan is based on the information available to you. Finally, tasawwuf can help us lead this world behind guides, this world behind leaders and guides. We spoke about individualism and how the current media and technology is actually promoting individualism. And there is no problem in individualism itself. The problem is when to take it as the only way of living. So what we need nowadays is to bring the balance between individualism and collectivism. There are situations when we can take decisions as individuals, but there are other situations when we have to take them as a collective. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that we have sometimes to be together. But once we start to live as individuals and everyone becomes the leader of himself, problems will start to appear. The world is living in a big chaos today because of this. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Idha ra'aita shuhhan muta'an," when you see people listening to their own stinginess, "wa hawan muttaba'an," and everyone is following his own desire, "wa i'jabu kulli dhi ra'yin bi ra'yihi," and everyone is likes only his own opinion, "fantazir as-sa'a," then wait for the day of judgment, because the day of judgment will come when the world is in complete chaos. Tasawwuf teaches us two important things, that we have to work under a leader, because this is the nature of life. Even sheep have a leader for their heads. If there was no need for leadership, Allah wouldn't have sent prophets and messengers. But they had to come down to become the leaders, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave humanity without leadership. But sometimes humanity decide to be under no leadership. And this is where tasawwuf should come, to tell people that you are nothing without leaders. You need the experienced to lead the unexperienced. That in the journey of life, you need someone who has traveled before and has come back to lead you. That if you are an unexperienced traveler or a passenger, you cannot tell the driver how to take you, because he's been on this way for so many times. No one can travel an untrodden path unless he is under the leadership of someone who's traveled before. And the second area leadership can save us in is to open our eyes to understand that everything is not as we see it. That sometimes we see certain things, but the reality is completely different. And when you are unable to see clearly, you should give your complete trust to your leader. A blind cannot tell us how strong is the sunlight. To a blind person, all the colors are the same. Only philosophers challenge this, by the way. But even that is challengeable. The reality is, not everything that we see is as it is. A simple proof of this is that you see a train very small, but in reality it is big.
Pardon?
A very simple proof of this is that you see a train from far, very small, but in reality it is big. While in the plane, you cannot tell the speed of the plane. Only an experienced person can tell you the actual speed of it. But being an insider means you might be thinking that you are still in your place. Sometimes we see in the world today certain situations which we think that this group is right or that group, but the true people of Allah tell us that it's called a fitna. And the nature of fitna is to show the real colors of individuals. It's taken from the word fatan al-zahab, to put the gold in the fire. Because when you put metals in the fire, you will be able to separate them. And this is what difficulties and tribulations do to individuals. They will either shape you as a completely different human being, and you end up becoming either a loser or a winner. So you need someone to take you through this in the most, in the safest way. You need a leader to take you through these times in the safest way, to remind you all the time to be calm and not to lose focus, and don't look at the outward, and don't trust your senses all the time, because they have already deceived you before. When the sorcerers and the magicians appeared in the presence of Fir'aun, they played on people's senses, as the Quran actually says, وَسَحَرُوا أَعْيُنَ النَّاسِ. They did magic on the eyes of people. They didn't change the items, but they played on the minds.
True.
And this is what the media does nowadays. It is the modern magicians of Pharaoh. And this is what a Dajjal will do before the Day of Judgment. He will represent to us an image of fire, but in reality it is heavens. And will represent an image of heavens that is reality fire. Only those who use their heart will know the difference. But those who use their senses will not know anything. The problem of Banu Israel was in their senses. Remember that Musa alayhi salam accompanied Al-Khadr alayhi salam in three different journeys. And in all these three journeys, his mind did not help him, because he saw things through his senses. What tasawwuf can help us with nowadays is to tell us to try using our hearts, because people have become too materialistic. And in a materialistic context, man follows his senses. There are so many other areas that tasawwuf can help us with, and there are so many roles that tasawwuf can play today. We just need to think deep about it and to reread the history of tasawwuf and speak to the righteous people who know its realities, and always combine it with knowledge and sincerity. In this way we will be saved. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from the troubles of this world and save us from the troubles of the hereafter.
Ameen.
Allahu Akbar.